Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Today's pep talk is going to be around a very, very touchy subject, and that is the nakedness. When you are home alone, can you be naked as you like, or are there any restrictions? This question today came in the group where somebody asked about being naked, especially due to the hot weather, and that they heard that if you sleep naked, then the jinn will have sex with you. Also, some other cultures and some other hadith, quote-unquote, they say that if you go to the toilet and you don't do certain things and you don't mention certain things, then the jinn will play with your private parts and other beliefs of such an ilk. And before I get started, I want to make sure that you understand one reality. And that reality is the way the Quran speaks about a shaitan and the way the ahadith speak about a shaitan is a completely different world. It's a completely different subject altogether. A shaitan is portrayed in the Quran as a big, huge player, so much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to take him as an enemy. But the ahadith renders a shaitan to someone who is completely idiot. When he hears the adhan, he takes off and farts. But this actually is not what happens. The hadith tells you that when you eat and you don't mention Bismillah, he will eat with you. And if you enter the home and you don't say the dua, he will enter with you. And when you sleep, he will sleep with you. Just this morning, somebody sent me a question that is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, that at night a shaitan sleeps on your nose. All these ahadith are narrations. They are not mentioned in the Quran. Al-Quran depicts and portrays a shaitan as much, much bigger, hugely, hugely dangerous than to sleep with you on your nose or eat with you or things like that. Couple things. Our food, the shaitan cannot eat. Our food is not what a shaitan eats. He's got his own different foods. That is one thing. The other thing is, for example, you find some ahadith where they say that when the woman comes out of the home, istasharafaha shaitan, i.e. the shaitan rides a woman, just like you ride a donkey or a car or whatever it is. But is that true? Of course not. But as I said, that scholars said that this culture of a shaitan as depicted in the hadith makes the shaitan somebody who is completely idiot. But the shaitan is a creature of evil, plain and simple, who is on a mission to spread evil, beautify evil, and fill the earth with evil. This is his purpose. Take with him as much as he can of mankind to hell fire. This is, and this has always been, his never-ending mission till his death. His relationship with us humans started on that fateful day when he refused to honor our father Adam. Just like every angel on that day, all that was required of him was to put his forehead on the ground. But that was already way too much for him, and that was the straw that broke the camel's back. I don't want to go into the whole story again because you can find most of it on my YouTube channel, but I just want to say something and emphasize that ash-shaytan has come a long, long way with humanity, and he will die one day, shortly right or with the last man to die on earth. As I already mentioned, that the reason behind this is the question and the vile beliefs that people have about ash-shaytan and nakedness. And I will answer this for all types out there, and I mean for singles, when you are home in your own private environment and you want to be naked. And I am going to speak about individuals that are single, like single men, single women, or as a couple married, either together or individually. And bi'idhnillah, by the end of this talk, the picture will be so clear right in front of your eyes, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it in the Quran. It is very, very scary these days that Allah gives us two hands and the Muslim world has completely marginalized and isolated the left hand because the shaitan uses it. So Allah gives us two hands and we use only one hand. So much so that the Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen alayhi rahmatullah was asked one day about eating with the left hand. He said, well, if you can eat with the right hand, eat with the right hand. But if you can't, or for example, in one, the right hand you have the spoon and the left hand you have the bread, you can eat with both hands. There is no problem at it at all. And this is might come to a surprise to you. Sometimes even if you pick up a glass of water and you drink with the left hand, you've already said Bismillah and you don't intend to copy a shaitan, if that is what he does. Anyway, so why is it a sin? Why is it haram? It is unbelievable what Muslims, the state of Muslims when it comes to their belief. You see a lot of people, if you eat with the left hand, they will frown upon you, they will degrade you, they will even think you are a shaitan yourself. But these very same people that eat and ensure they don't involve the left hand in their eating, when they go out, they become Satan himself with backbiting, by corruption, by lies, by taking the rights of human beings, by being just nasty, plain, nasty people. And they think by eating the right hand, that's it, they have become un-shaitanic and holy. My dear brothers and my sisters, it's not, and I will say it explicitly and plain because I've had enough of all these false preachings. It is not which hand you eat with that is going to define who you are, but it is furthermore how you are with people that is going to define who you are. What's the purpose of eating with the right hand all the way through? And when you are out there, you backbite, you lie, you fornicate, you drink wine, you smoke, you. It is time to actually wake up and start taking the Quran seriously. Allah gave us two hands, and until and unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explicitly forbid that with me, the possibility of using the left hand remains open and at your disposal. You understand? The culture of Al-Quran, how Allah wants us to take Al-Quran, is far more than that. By studying Al-Quran very, very closely and paying attention to what Allah says in there, you can find there is absolutely not a mention of being naked at home as something prohibited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I have to emphasize here, I am talking about the nakedness within the four walls of your home. I'm not talking outside or to go to the naturalist clubs or whatever on the beach or something like that. I'm talking here in your own residence at home, and you are by yourself unless you are married. This is what I'm discussing here. As I said, the Quran says nothing about the nakedness and that it is haram. There is absolutely nothing in Al-Quran. But this whole situation goes completely upside down as soon as you take the route of the hadith. As soon as you start looking at this subject from a hadith angle, it comes back to you as a completely different ball game altogether. And that the nakedness topic is judged under the hadith, and that the human interpretations of those hadiths, and then you really have a big ball of a complete mess, as you shall see, inshallah. So what has triggered this topic in the hadith? Well, the culprit is a hadith authenticated by Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani, alayhi rahmatullah, and this is reported in Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, and Ibn Majah, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said the following hadith. A man came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked him about his awrah, what he should cover of it. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him in the meaning, احفظ عورتك إلا من زوجتك أو ما ملكت يمينك, i.e. cover and protect your awrah except from your wife or what your right hand possesses, slaves and the likes. The man said to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, قلت يا رسول الله, يا رسول الله, إذا كان القوم بعضهم في بعض, if people were together, like when you are in swimming pool or a gym and you want to take a shower and that kind of situation, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا استطعت ألا يرينها أحدا فلا يرينها أحد. If you could protect so that your awra, i.e. your front or your back or any part of you, cannot be seen by somebody else, then do your utmost at them not seeing it. قلت, I said, this is the man again talking, يا رسول الله, إذا كان أحد خاليا, if one of us was by himself at home, alone in his own privacy, قال, he said, رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, الله أحق أن يستحيا منه من الناس, it is more befit that you should respect Allah and not be naked in front of him, than you would do it in front of other people. So if you are shy and you don't want other people to see you naked, then you should consider Allah at more and higher degree than that. This is exactly what is and what was and what is that the scholars are building their arguments upon these days. It is this hadith, as I said, that all what you hear about haram and things like that, this is the root of the hadith. A huge number of scholars went for the opinion that it is haram, and they used the term haram. And as I said before, you only use the term haram when Allah has used it explicitly in Al-Quran or in a hadith that doesn't contradict Al-Quran. But anyway, so they say it is haram to be naked when alone, but they excluded few conditions and situations. Some expanded on the number of these exclusions, while others tightened and limited their number. Yet, even those who permitted it said that it is out of exception, while the norm is haram. It is just you do it because you need it, and as soon as that need is finished, then you get back. For example, they say when you go to the toilet, you need to uncover yourself. Then that is a need. And as soon as you finish, you cover yourself. Or when you take a shower, you do it as quick as you can. According to these people, if your shower deserves 5 minutes, you are not allowed to go for 6 minutes. It's like a quickie job done. So for them, prolonged baths is a no-no, because you'll be naked for all this and there is no necessity for you or neediness for you to be naked. Yet even those, as I said, who permitted it, they tightened the noose almost like to make it impossible. This is why 3 years ago, a huge great scholar in Egypt, he was one of the top people in Al-Azhar University, issued a fatwa that if a man sees his wife naked and the woman sees her husband naked, the divorce takes place. And as I said before, this made the laughingstock of our religion in worldwide, because they narrated that in the United States in the news. Yes, we hate when they do that, but we give them the opportunity to do that kind of things. To cut the path for people to doubt that ruling that it is haram to uncover yourself, they even asked and answered a very pertinent question. The question goes like this: how would nakedness be a lack of respect to Allah when He can see us and see our bare bodies under our clothes? Because Allah, the clothes will not cover us from Allah. He sees us completely naked. And they answered and they said, Allah sees His subservient, humble, modest, and covered, unlike other people who deliberately show their private parts to Allah. So as you can see, they asked the question and answered it. Then they take their arguments to women. They said, even if a woman is in dire need to cool herself, she can't reveal her thighs and she has to bear the heat until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when she goes to bed or something like that. For them, it is not permitted for a woman to uncover her thighs or her back or anything to even cool down. And this is an agreement in this Hanafi school of thought, the Hanbali school of thought, and the Shafi'i school of thought. However, the Shafi'i school of thought, they said, cooling oneself is enough of a reason to expose the awrah, but she mustn't sleep in that way. As you can see, even if there was an exception, they still had to control the level of how much or how little. However, the Maliki school of thought went against the three opinions altogether. And they said, nakedness in solitude or with a legit partner, i.e. husband or wife, only is a disliked act. And this is for the front and behind. And I explain here. What they're saying is this: what a couple or individual, either man or a woman, husband and wife, either together or separate, what they can is they can be completely naked except if, for example, they wear underwear to cover the front and the back. This is only disliked. It is not haram at all to do that. And they also said, for the rest of the body, it is completely halal. So a woman can wear a short, for example, at home and remain topless, and that is absolutely fantastic. That is fine for them. Needless to say, this opinion here is completely alienated in the three other school of thoughts, And whenever you ask any scholar of the Hanafi or the Hanbali or the Shafi'i school of thought, they will tell you it is haram. But as you will see, we will discuss these arguments later and get, inshallah, to what Al-Quran says. And then you will find that the beauty of Islam is really in Al-Quran, not in the sayings of the scholars and not into these extra additions. What the Maliki school of thought said is absolutely fantastic, and they really are the champions. And that's because they brought forward and prioritized Al-Quran, and they did not ignore it like the other three school of thoughts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-A'raf, that is the surah number 7, and the ayah number 26. He said, Ya Bani Adam, children of Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا We descended upon you clothing to conceal you, يُوَارِ سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا And also as a decoration. In Arabic, there is a difference between the word libas and thiyab. Libas is the external dress that you see outside. For example, the suit or the dress that you wear when you go outside. A thiyab is the underwear that you wear under the libas. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya qad anzalna alaykum libasan yuwari sawatikum, that is, we have on us today whatever we need to cover our private parts. And alhamdulillah for that. Al-Shaykh al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, who authenticated the hadith, is also of this opinion, i.e. men and women in their privacy, they can be naked and just need to cover their front and back, and that's that. And he also says, alayhi rahmatullah, that this is a general etiquette, but cannot be raised to the status of obligation or prohibition. It's just an etiquette. For example, if some etiquettes you don't show your shoulders, bare shoulders to your mother, that's just your etiquette. It does not make it haram and it does not make it halal. And this is, subhanAllah, is the pure truth, as we shall see further on. When you read and research any topic, you find different arguments and things like that. Just like this argument here about nakedness. As you can see, when people took the way of the hadith, they ended up prohibiting it completely. But when you take the way of the Quran, you find it actually is halal completely. And this shows the great pitfalls our scholars, may Allah have mercy on them, fell in the past and still fall in today when they ignore the Quran and base their judgments only on humanly narrated hadith that are claimed to have been said by the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when we have absolutely no guarantee that the actual hadith that you heard, even the one that I reported today, was actually uttered by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the first place. Let's see what the guidance book, Al-Quran, that is the true method of double-checking if something is halal or not, says about this. It's the true guidance. In Surah Fussilat, Fussilat in English is explained in further details, in details and deep details. Allah starts His powerful surah by emphasizing the clarity, power, and authenticity of what the Quran, the book of Allah, contains. Listen to these powerful words. Hamim, Hamim. Tanzilun min ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Sent down from ar-Rahman and ar-Rahim. Kitabun, a book. Fussilat ayatuhu, whose ayat have been explained properly and deeply. Qur'anan Arabiyan, a Qur'an that is in Arabic, liqawmin ya'lamun, for a people who know. Bashiran wa nadhira, a giver and bringer of good news, and a warner. Fa'arada aktharuhum, most of them turned away, fahum la yasma'un, and as such they do not listen. This is very dangerous. People today, as I said many times before, when you ask them to bring an ayah from the Quran, they turn away from you as if it is a huge problem. And Al-Quran, Allah says, has been explained in details. This is why, my dear sisters and my brothers, and whoever listens to my talk, our usuliyin, the scholars that deal with the roots of this deen, they said, it is impossible for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a messenger to bring something new that is not in Al-Quran. Everything that he had to convey to us is in Al-Quran, And then he explained it either in practice or in words as a prophet. He cannot add something that Allah didn't add. So if Allah has not prohibited that we get naked at home, it is impossible. And I can swear on it that Rasulullah ﷺ didn't say it. But anyway, in this surah, Fussilat, further down in the Quran, in the book, in ayah number 41, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks again about this Quran powerfully. And he says, وَإِنَّهُ لَكِتَابٌ عَزِيزٌ. And very indeed, it certainly is a mighty book. لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. No falsehood can come to it from the front, i.e. in the future, or from its behind, i.e. the past. Whatever the Quran spoke about in the past is true and authentic and will be proven so. And whatever the Quran speaks about for the future, it will be proven correct and it will be as such. And then he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, تَنْزِيلٌ مِنْ حَكِيمٍ حَمِيدٌ. A sent down revelation from a God that is wise and praiseworthy. So as you can see here, the Quran doesn't need anyone externally to explain it. Allah would never, ever let an external source to explain what's in the Quran. The keys to understanding the Quran exist in the Quran itself. You actually don't need anything more than that. This is why there is no full tafsir of the Quran by our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It would have been a calamity. This is why it didn't happen, because that would have meant that all the Quran will be just as explained by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it will not live with our time. It will be just relevant to the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is why what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did, as in the hadith sahih of Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha in al-Bukhari and Muslim, when a man asked her about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he was, she said, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His behavior, his moral, his attitude, who he was, everything that he did was Al-Qur'an. And this should be explicit to us. I don't know where we went wrong. So as you can see here, our scholars took the route of taking a hadith and they prohibited, and now worldwide in the Muslim mind, any person who is naked at home is haram, is committed haram, and you are being disrespectful to Allah, when in fact it doesn't mean that at all. Back to our subject about nakedness in privacy settings. In the Quran, and that is the pure truth, a human awra is their front and back. As for women, and due to their physical sexiness, Allah put further details about what they should cover when in public. But in privacy, hers and the man's awra are exactly the same, the front and the back. Even the breasts are not considered awra when she is home alone or with her partner. If she wants to walk inside her house braless, then she can do that. Absolutely, she can do that. No problem with it at all. It's the same thing. Obviously, the male-driven culture would make that a big evil. It's awra. Actually, no. Allah says in the Quran, Ya Bani Adam, children of Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا. We certainly have sent down upon you a libas, a clothing, يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ, that covers your saw'at, that is the front and back part. And he didn't mention the breasts or the back, and he said, وَرِيشَ, and a decoration, adornment for you. Furthermore, my dear sisters and my brothers, in Surah An-Nur, that is translated into the light, that's the meaning, Allah further illuminates us on how to use the clothing that He so very kindly and generously descended upon us, and didn't leave us undressed just like dogs, cats, and monkeys. He gave us these clothes. No other creatures on earth enjoy this enjoyment as we do. And notice that the explanation of how you can be when in private is right in front of your eyes in this ayah that I am going to mention in Surah An-Nur. So much so that any who acts as the ayah suggests is really bathing in light. And those who don't do what the ayah suggests are really living in the dark. Look at the beauty of Al-Quran and you will understand what I mean right now. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you who believe. Now, when Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you who believe, He talks to both men, women. It's not gender at all. It's a description of those who have this quality of belief. So it includes men and women.
لِيَسْتَأْذِنْكُمُ الَّذِينَ مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. Let those whom your right hand possess seek your permission. وَالَّذِينَ لَمْ يَبْلُغُوا الْحُلُمَ مِنْكُمْ.
And those that have not reached the age of puberty of you.
ثلاث مرات. Three times.
من قبل صلاة الفجر. Before the salat of the fajr.
وحين تضعون ثيابكم من الظهيرة.
And when you put down your ثياب. Remember when I said لباس is the external. ثياب is the internal. I.e. when you get naked at noon.
ومن بعد صلاة العشاء.
And after صلاة العشاء.
ثلاث عورات لكم.
These are three times of your private times for yourselves. And this is in Surah An-Nur, the light, ayah number 58. And you see, you've read the Quran so many times, and perhaps this is the first time you pay attention to it. What Allah is telling us here is this. You who believe, both men and women, you have three times of utmost private moment for your lives, where you can remove your underwear, i.e. whatever you wear on the thing. Always remember that we should cover the front and back awrah, the minimum. And we have three times to do this. After Salat al-Isha, until Fajr. So that means when you go to sleep, you can sleep naked if you want to. There is absolutely no problem, especially that you're going to cover yourself with a blanket or whatever it is. But if you are not going to cover yourself with blanket like it's right here, sleep with your underwear, with the short, with things like that, and you can be topless, absolutely no right. And not only that, Allah says, in the midst of the day, when you want to do a qailula, you can actually go to your private room and you can get naked. Again, as I said before, if you're going to cover yourself, you can sleep completely naked. But if you are not going to cover yourself, wear the minimum to cover your private parts, the front and the back, as mentioned in Al-Quran, and sleep well. Those servants or those people that you possess and your children, within those three times, they cannot enter freely your room until they take and seek permission. Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah said, what is the purpose of a permission if you are sleeping with your clothes? The permission, as the ayah explicitly mentions, is because we are naked down to our underwear. Isn't the Quran beautiful? Now, you can see very much so how a hadith can contradict Al-Quran, and how Al-Hadith is studied away from Al-Quran, and how many scholars and the majority of the scholars and so many thoughts and school of thoughts and also promotions for the last 14 centuries kept promoting something that Al-Quran disagrees with. But if they took a little time to actually study the Quran before this hadith, they would never have reached here. Now you can tell me how these scholars have failed this. Exactly like it's happening today. So many of them put so much emphasis on the hadith, far more than the Quran, and the problems we're facing today on earth is because of this. We have to go first and see what Allah says about any issue in Al-Quran first. And then, when we find the ayah, perhaps if the Quran, as I said in Surah Fussila, that explains itself with details, if for whatever reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't tell us exactly what we do, we will find it in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the authentic sunnah that explains that which has not been explained in Al-Quran, and I doubt anything that was not explained in Al-Quran first. When this argument of yes, you can do that, and because of the exceptions, some clergymen or scholars wanted to add some exceptions to this ayah. And they started trying to get like, yes, you can do that, but, subhanAllah, other scholars have responded to them. They said, you have absolutely no right to manipulate the meaning of the ayah. Leave it as it is. Allah talks to those who believe. He doesn't talk to PhD holders or to messengers. And those who believe could be aged 16, 17, and they could be aged 70. And all of them will understand it according to their age and era. What is today? Women today wear bra. At the time of Rasulullah, they didn't have a bra. We today wear underwear with all those colors and shapes and forms and all these things. At the time of Rasulullah, they didn't have that kind of stuff. So today, Islam talks to people that live. Al-Quran, look my brothers, Al-Quran lives with us. Do you know why? Because it's alive. And it is the live words of a God that is alive. And Allah is alive, and He talks to alive people, you and me. The Quran is not a dead book that talks to people that are dead. So to me today, when someone tells me, you are being disrespectful to Allah when you are naked, I will tell him, fear Allah, because Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An-Nur, the light, that ayah 58, that you actually have three times every single 24 hours when you can be completely naked at your own ease and pleasure. So who do I believe, a hadith or an ayah? Food for thought. This will lead me to say that all that you know about being naked, just throw it away, trash it out. Alhamdulillah, you are completely, and I will reiterate again, for a single man or a single woman, or a couple together, or when they are separate. When you are within the four walls of your home, you can do as you please. The minimum that you should cover is the before and the behind. Wear your underwear and then you stay as you are, and you can clean your kitchen and you can do whatever you want to do within the confines of your four walls. If you are hot or at night it's hot and you want to sleep naked, as I said, it's within your own realm. Alhamdulillah for the beauty of Islam when taken directly from Al-Quran. Always remember this. All the hardships that you go through today is because people have prioritized something else than the Quran. And Allah is punishing us greatly. Now, I want to go to the second part about the jinn having sex with people who sleep naked. And also with the jinn that will play with your private parts when you go to the toilet and that kind of things. The Torah doesn't speak much about Satan, almost at all. It just refers to him indirectly as if he was not part of the deal. But the Gospel or the New Testament speaks a lot about a shaitan. Now, why am I bringing the Torah and the Gospel? Because we live in the West. And you need to know some arguments so that if you speak to Christians, and I will swear to you today, you are going to be surprised by learning at least one fact. And that fact there will tell you how much of what's happening around us, we are not aware of it. A shaitan is a very, very touchy subject, because the Muslims today, instead of reading the Quran and understanding what Allah wants to tell us, they chose to believe anything else but Al-Quran. A shaitan, as I said before, or the jinn, will not inhabit a person. He cannot go inside you and control you. For example, he cannot inhabit me, and tomorrow you can find me in a bar drinking wine. So if you do that, and then I will tell you, I don't want to be here. It's my shaitan inside me, you see? If I don't pray, it's still my shaitan. If you fornicate, it's not you. It's the jinn inside you. And since when Allah has given power to the jinn to do that to a human? Hasn't a shaitan in Surah Ibrahim, alayhi salam, in Surah Ibrahim, where he gave his really thrilling, chilling, horrifying khutbah on the day of Al-Qiyamah inside hellfire, when he said, وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ, I had absolutely no power, no authority over you, إِنَّمَا دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي, only that I called you and you responded to my call. فَلَا تَلُومُونِي, do not blame me. وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, and blame yourselves. مَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُصْرِخِي, you are not about to save me from where I am now in hellfire. وَمَا أَنَا بِمُصْرِخِكُمْ, and I am not to save you at all. إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ, I am scared of Allah. This is what shaitan can do, Al-Quran. This is not a hadith, this is not some anything. This is Al-Quran. وَمَا كَانَ لِيَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ, I had absolutely no authority or power or anything or control or anything over you. Allah will not let a shaitan do what he likes just because he's a shaitan. Al-Quran explains to us that at the beginning, when our father Adam alayhi salam came to earth, he could see a shaitan. And there were throughout history fights and all these things with being a shaitan until the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. But then again, a shaitan has been curbed. He is now forced to work entirely in secrecy and stealth. And he is, and his offspring, that his weapon is the waswas, the whispering, the suggestions. He is a vicious enemy to all human souls. But non-appearance is a significant containment of his powers. Allah did not give him the powers to appear. Jinn and shaitan cannot appear. They cannot be seen by humans until the last day of judgment. And the same thing for the angels. No babies of one day, no babies of 7 days, and no one at all can see either the jinn or the angels. These are creatures made of completely different materials. We cannot see them with our eyes. My dear sisters and my brothers, Satan or Ash-Shaytan or Lucifer or Iblis or whatever you want to refer to him is now a spiritual rolling stone. Powerful? Oh yes, he is powerful. But he has at his service a great number of his kin and humans that are doing his bidding. But at the end of the day, he must only and can only tempt us from outside. To secure our cooperation for everything he wants us to do, put 1 billion lions under outside. He cannot, he will never be able to force you to do anything at all. Shaitan is not mentioned in the Old Testament, as I already mentioned, and there is indirect references to him, and that's very strange. And before I go further, some wrong beliefs have always polluted the life and minds of great people. Have you ever thought about why it has become a given fact that men should have short hair and women long hair? Have you actually even thought, you, my sister, and you, my brother, have you ever thought about why ladies have long hair and men have short hair? The truth is really, really neatly depicted in the Bible, in the New Testament, in Corinthians, and that is chapter 11 and verses from 12 to 15. Listen and learn. Number 12, this is verse number 12. For as woman come from man, so also man is born of a woman. But everything comes from God. Verse 13. Judge for yourself. Is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Number 14. Does not the very nature of things teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace for him? And verse number 15. But that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory. For long hair is given to her as a covering. And now you understand why women have long hair. Because it's a teaching in the Bible that got turned today into normal thing. For a woman, having a long hair is a covering for her. To cover what? To cover her chastity, her chest, whatever it is. But just as the Bible said. But what? That if a woman has long hair, it is her glory. For long hair is given by Allah to her as a covering. Did you know this before? So you can see we do have a lot of wrong culture in us. We take for granted, but in fact, it needs to be questioned. And my question now is, does it really appear to be right that when you are naked, al-shaytan will have sex with you? And that when I am naked, a female jinn is going to have sex with me? Is this really true? These two questions need thinking not, because they are so obviously simple, as the Quran has already mentioned. Ash-Shaytan has no control with us, doesn't touch us, doesn't do anything. The only thing he does is whisper. That's all there is to it. And one last thing before I wrap up this pep talk here. I want to say this. Loving oneself, loving one's body, appreciating who you are as a human being, and appreciating what Allah has given to you, either prettiness in the face or fluidity and blood-boiling physical curvature in that body, or that you look at yourself in the mirror, either incidentally, when you don't mean to, or purposefully, admire your body, the way you look, all these things are 100% your right. It is halal for you to do all these things. You do not have to rub your face in charcoal as a sign of humbleness just because you are pretty. And you don't have to eat 7 fattening donuts because you think by being slender and sexy is going to make you less pious in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That and the other things are certainly untrue and go against the teachings of Al-Quran when Allah says, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. When Allah bestows upon you a gift, a divine gift, beauty, sexiness, intelligence, everything, فَحَدِّثْ, expose them, tell them to people. The Muslim world today is sick. Why? Because they are scared of the ayn, of envy, and they hide everything. And the Quran tells you, when Allah has bestowed upon you a mercy, as in Surah Al-Duha, share it with the others. Share it with the others. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. When Allah bestows something upon you, tell people, share with people. My dear brothers and my sisters, you can choose to prioritize the book of Allah and dwell in its detailed explanations that will certainly lead you to light, as you have seen tonight about this pep talk here. Or you can secondarize the holy book and prioritize the hadith and what the scholars say, you know, all that kind of stuff, and go with those teachings that contradict the meaning of the Quran and spend the rest of your life walking in darkness. That is your choice, and you choose it. But I choose to prioritize the book of Allah, and life can be tons easy. Don't you feel Islam is easy when you listen to these pep talks? How when you prioritize the Quran? It is important to remember that Allah created beauty and sex to be a beautiful expression of love between married couples. As such, the unseen world of the jinn can never, ever be revealed to mankind, and they can never, ever have sex or touch you or tickle you or pull things or do whatever they do to you. It doesn't happen whatsoever. We humans are made of hard stuff, the earth, bones and blood and things like that. The jinn are spirits. We do not have the same components. It's like when you say a jinn is having sex with you, it's just like you saying the air I breathe is having sex with me. It just doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. Humans are a mass. We are a mass. While the jinn are a spirit. They're kind of like a vapor or something like that, with no mass at all. And again, my dear sisters and my brothers, saying that when you are naked is haram is a huge lie. And especially using the term haram, na'udhu billah, because only Allah has a right to say the word haram. Every human on earth cannot use that term unless we have an explicit evidence from Al-Quran that says haram. Someone comes to you and says, can I marry my mother? You tell him at that moment there, it's haram. Why? Because Allah says in Al-Quran, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ. Allah used the term haram in front of marrying the mothers. So, to recap my whole talk, my dear sisters and my brothers, for you to be naked at home, by all means, go ahead, be naked. If you are in your own bedroom, you can sleep naked, you can sleep naked. When you go to bed, you cover yourself. What happens after you fall asleep is nothing to do with you. Okay, that's one. Number two, if you want to wear an underwear, okay, for men and women, by all means, go ahead and you can stay topless and reveal your thighs. That is absolutely fantastic. For a husband and a wife, the same thing. You can do as you please. That is your given God right. This is what Allah has given you. Don't let any human being take it away from you. It doesn't matter how Sheikh Islam he is or she is. The only Sheikh of Islam is Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Every other human there is just a person who Allah has given him knowledge. Today we have this huge title, Sheikh al-Islam, the Sheikh of the Huffad, the highest scholar. That's it. It's no longer enough that Allah has bestowed a knowledge upon these people. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this talk here will open your eyes to the beauty of Islam. So go ahead, my dear sisters and my brothers, when it's hot, wear them shorts and wear them t-shirts if you want to, and if you want to stay topless, that's your choice, and enjoy the beautiful Islam that Allah has given you. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. I didn't mean for this talk to take this long, but it's needed treatment and some kind of like a chemotherapy to remove the dead cells of the cancer of ignorance that has hit Muslims today. Jinn making love to humans. Wallahi al-Azim, what's next? In any case, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. To join my group on WhatsApp, please do send me a message on 0044 78 76 40 87 35. And until my next message to you, you be in the rahmah of Allah. And salli Allahumma ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.